So students, in this case, you have realized in this newest e-assessment scheme, it is the NEC is a game changer. NEC, National E-Assessment Center. They are the one who are going to interface with the SSE. They are the one who are going to interface with the assessment unit. There are some assessment unit, review unit, technical units are there. But they will report to NEC. Okay. And NEC, whatever is the final thing, they will push. NEC will push to the SSE. Whatever is received from the SSE, accordingly NEC will look into it and then they will push to the respective units. So it is the NEC which is the central or the focal point in the entire e-assessment scheme. NEC. And accordingly, let's quickly go one by one. We will do primarily the e-assessment which you will have to do. General points and penalty for non-compliance, you can just let it go. You can just focus on the flow. How the flow, just try to understand the flow, because that you, this is visualization, because it's in the, all would be now online. So point number one, National E-Assessment Center shall serve notice under section 143 subsection 2, specifying the issues for selection of his case to the SSE. So therefore, as I told you, it is the NEC who shall be serving the notice under 143.2, specifying the issues for a selection of his case to the SSE. Primarily, when I used to say that the notice, the scrutiny cases are being picked up 5 or 10%, that is, we don't have any parameters. What is the parameter of picking up the case for scrutiny? Nobody knows. So there is some sort of system intelligence which gets applicable, on the basis of which they pick up the case in scrutiny. And that system intelligence is majorly because of that e-filing of the return, in which case all the fields are there. So they have got some ratios of like transport, traveling charges versus sale. They actually get a lot of ratios done because it's e-filing now. So they can easily program their system, and through programming they can get a lot of ratios as well. And through ratios, lot of intelligence, or it's like an MIS. They can easily know where to check and how to check. All that things are there in front of them. And that is what is a system intelligence that they will rely upon for the purpose of selecting the case for scrutiny. Because 143.2, we all know, it is for scrutiny purpose. Point number two. NEC shall assign the case through automated allocation system to the assessment unit. This is generally your AO, the ward AO, where the assessment goes. But now they will decide. It will not go automatically. They will allocate to the relevant assessment unit of one of the regional e-assessment center. So your national is Delhi, and from Delhi it goes to the regional center, e-assessment center, and from there it will go to one of the assessment unit. So accordingly, in this case, so this is how the allocations are done. From national, which is in Delhi, primarily it will go to the relevant state, and in that state relevant unit, primarily which is wherever it is next to my, whichever is the unit which I am residing, primarily that will be one of the unit. Assessment unit will request to NEC for what they are going to request? Obtaining such other information, documents from SSE or any other person. So the assessment unit will not give the notice to the SSE. Give us this, give us that, nothing of that sort. They will request to NEC. We want this document. NEC will, okay, fine. I'll do what? I'll mail it. And they will mail and call for the documents. And documents also you have to upload. So assessment unit may request to the NEC, not to the SSE. Be very careful on this. For obtaining any such other information, so documents and from the SSE or any other person, conduct a certain inquiry or verification by a verification unit. So there is a assessment unit, verification unit, or technical assistant. Like verification unit may do a survey. Now this verification unit will also not be of the assessment people. This verification unit will be of the investigation people. The person who are on the verification side, they are nothing but on the investigation side. They want to ensure that this AO does not go to the SSE at all. The entire thought is like that. So that if he gets an opportunity to the SSE, he will give the hint to the SSE. And he will tell what? I am doing your assessment. So you give me the money now so that I will just ensure that everything is fine. So that is one thing that he will not be allowed to interact with the SSC. So if they want to do like survey kind of a thing, so that would be done by whom? By the verification unit. And the people who are there in the verification unit are majorly the people from the investigation department, not from the assessment department. And that is the reason why the interface they want to take out of the AO. From whom? From the SSC. Okay, and the last one is about a technical, like valuation department. Okay, so they want to do some valuation done. So that will be referred to whom? To the technical unit. So depending upon the nature of the requirement, the assessment unit may request to whom? To the NAC. Depending upon the nature of requirement, the assessment unit will request it to NAC. Point 4, on receipt, on request of the assessment unit, NAC shall oblige. So if the request is for the technical side, it will be going to the technical unit. Verification, then it will go to the verification, so on and so forth. Or any information that is required from the SSC, or any information. Now 133 information. Like, see, it can be from the SSC also, or it can be from whom? From any other person. So from SSC or from any other person. So how the NEC will get the information from any other person? By giving the notice under 133. But who will give the notice? NEC, and not the assessment unit. On receipt on request of assessment unit, NEC shall issue whatever are the relevant notice. Let's see point number 5. The assessment unit shall, after taking into account, this is what the language was. Remember my order, assessment order. What is the assessment order of 143? The diagram that you prepared. What was the diagram that you all prepared? In the last line, what I said in that diagram, just see, you have forgotten by now. What was that language? After taking into account all the relevant material gathered by the AO, he shall pass what? The total income. Have a look to your time scale diagram, 143, one, that master chart, in which case the powers also was being introduced. All the powers also were being introduced in that case. And below that I have written for intimation also. That intimation is on the basis of ROI. Whereas order pass is on the basis of the, after taking into account all the materials which is gathered by the AO. So that is the difference between the two. Be very careful. So because this is a scrutiny, and after scrutiny the order would be passed, therefore this language has to tally. Please try to visualize this thing, because if you cannot visualize this one and the link and flow, it will become very difficult towards the end. Right now there is a space, but towards the end it will become difficult. Point 5 therefore is, the assessment unit shall, after taking into account all the relevant materials available on record, just above that, right, 143.3. So the assessment unit shall, after taking into account all the relevant materials available on record, make a draft assessment order. Where otherwise you came across a draft assessment? One more place draft assessment order came. Where else the draft assessment order came? Transfer Pricing Officer, that was the DRP. In the DRP, the draft assessment orders were being passed, isn't it? Here also the same procedure will be followed. So after taking into account all the relevant material available on the record, make a draft assessment order with penalty proceedings to be initiated. Which penalty proceedings? 270A. Either accepting the returned income of the SSC or modifying the same. So either you accept as whatever is there, or you accepting the returned income of the SSC or modifying the same, as the case may be, and send a copy of such order. Which order? Draft order, to the NEC. So the assessment unit will be giving what? Give the draft assessment order along with the initiation of the penalty proceedings. So that is what they will give it to whom? To the NEC. Now the NEC will give the, I have told you, assessment unit will never interface with the SSC. Keep that always in mind. So point number 6, what it says, The NSE shall examine the draft assessment order in accordance with the risk management strategy specified by the board, including by way of what? Automated examination tool, whereupon it may decide to. Now, assessment unit, if they would not have done it properly, or maybe like they want to just check whether the assessment unit has done the work properly, so there is some standard practices that would be followed across all the assessment, which would also be programmed definitely. So each of the draft order will have to comply with the standard practice. Okay, now that standard practice, who will apply the standard practice? NEC. Once they get the draft assessment order from the assessment unit, they will apply that standard practice tools which the CBDT would have given to be applied on all the assessment draft orders. So they will do the same. So accordingly, what happens is that they will whereupon it may decide to finalize the assessment as per the draft assessment order. So they will finalize the assessment as per the draft assessment order and serve a copy of such order and notice of demand of such sum payable or refundable as per such assessment, along with initiating the penalty proceedings or provide an opportunity to the SSC in case of modification is proposed by serving a show cause notice. So in that particular case, they can either go for that draft after doing the whatever is the final standard practices, they can give a final order, or they can still think of giving what? A final opportunity on the basis of that draft order. That is what NEC can decide upon. Or assign the draft assessment order to another review unit in one of the REC. Now that review unit would be majorly the JCID level people, the bit higher authority. This review unit are generally meant when the stakes are high, like in 147 cases. So they may think that the stakes are very high, or like specialized case, like stock broker, I was talking about it. So they may give it to some review unit so as to review these particular order before the final assessment order is passed. So 7 point, if it is going to the review unit conducts review and may concur. So review unit generally consists of, you can write, generally consists of JCIT. So this unit will consist of JCIT. So review unit shall conduct a review and may concur or suggest modification of such order to whom? To the NEC. Point number 8, NEC on receipt of concurrence from the review unit shall finalize the order or provide opportunity of being heard to whom? To the SSC. So once they get the concurrence from whom? From the review unit. What they will do? They shall finalize the order. And now, underline the word finalize the order. So at this point of time, they are finalizing order. Point number 8. So the order is getting final. Or provide opportunity of being heard to the SSC as per step number 6. Point number 9. Assessment unit, after considering suggestion and modification of review unit, shall send final draft assessment order to the NEC. Now this finalization would be done by the assessment unit after the review unit has been given. And thereafter, point number 10, NEC on receipt of the final draft assessment order from the assessment unit shall finalize the order. Actually, this finalize of the order is over here. So students, just take my underline this one. That was a finalization of the order based on the review unit and finalizing the draft order. And this is the final order which is now being passed. So this is at point number 10. So NEC on receipt of final draft order from the assessment unit shall finalize the order or provide opportunity of being heard to the SSC as per step 6A or B. If procedure as per point B is followed, then SSC shall may file response to the show cause notice. Anyways, so primarily this is what it would be, students. And after that, this is what I think up till point number 10, just underline till point number 10, because after that there are general points, rectification of mistake and imposition of penalty, just up till point number 10. This is what you need to do, 1 to 10. Okay. Keep reading this 1 to 10 only. as far as e-assessment scheme is concerned, this is the entire game that has been there as far as this e-assessment scheme is concerned. Now with that, we are done, we are through with this particular part, and I want the last particular point to be done, and that is about this statement of financial transaction. Let's do this final one, because after this it's only the surrogate taxes. Statement of financial transaction. Now what is this AIR? There are, like, when you give the PAN, when you have to furnish the PAN, isn't it, for the various transaction, like when you withdraw the money 50,000 rupees from the bank, or more than 50,000 rupees, or your deposit, PAN has to be given. Have you wondered what these person will do about the PAN? They are the one, if the total transaction in the aggregate exceed the threshold, they have got the thresholds. If that exceed the threshold amount, then these person are required to file annual information return. All these bankers or the jewelers, on buying jewelry also you may have given the PAN, isn't it? So wherever motor vehicle, you have purchased motor car, so the motor vehicle authority, so accordingly, on the, when their aggregate transaction has exceeded the threshold value, then these people have to file an AIR, annual information return. And in the annual, that annual information return has to be filed by 31st of May of the next year. So for previous year 1920, whichever is the AIR which has been filed before me, I shall file the AIR which has been filed before me, I shall be filing, all for the previous year 1920, whatever is the PAN which has been filed or given to me in the transaction, then the AIR has to be filed by me. By when the AIR has to be filed? By 31st of May of the next year. Okay, so that is the AIR requirement that has to be furnished. Now, in this context, students, if the AIR has not been filed by these authorities, then there is some penalty. For non-filing, there is a penalty, and now there is a very important section about the inaccurate filing of the AIR. For that also, there is a penalty. Now, what this AIR will consist of? The AIR will consist of all the persons to who has given to them, to whom they have given, to the bank, or to the jeweler, or to the motor vehicle, or to the financial institutions for the debentures or purchase of debenture or sale of securities. So they will give the list of all the person's name, the value of the transaction, and the respective PAN number. To whom this return is filed, by the way, are you aware? To whom the return has been filed? This return is filed to the Director of Income Tax Investigation. To the Director of Income Tax Investigation that this return is filed, and with this idea, to the Income Tax Investigation that the return is filed, that Income Tax Investigation people know all about your transaction, whatever you have done in the previous year. Everything that you have done in the previous year, they will know everything about the transaction. That is what is, that is the case. And what this DIT investigation does, this DIT investigation will then, they have got the data of all the person who has done the transaction and what value through that return. So what they will do, through that PAN number, they will then shoot this transaction to whom? To the relevant AO, to the relevant assessing officer, that this assessee falls in your jurisdiction and this is what he has done the transaction. So wait for his return to be filed and see whether this particular return is showing this transaction or not. So that way, I tell you one important point, which is this: in any transaction where you have to furnish the PAN, never ever, ever, ever even think of not to disclose that transaction in your ROI or your books of accounts, as the case may be. Why is it so? The Income Tax Department already know about that particular transaction where you have furnished what? Your PAN. Any transaction that has to be recorded in the books, and also you need to capture those in your ROI. Any ingenuity on your part not to disclose this particular transaction in the books or ROI will attract additional tax plus the penalty as well would be charged. On that backdrop, students, we will do the amendments. What has been done here in AIR, these are the amendments part. Okay, so let's do the amendment part, because what they, if they have to target anything, they will target the amendment side in the examination. So let's have a look. 285 BA, inter alia provides for furnishing of statement of financial transaction or reportable account by person specified therein. Following amendments have been made to the said section with effect from 1st of September 2019. Point number A, section 285 BA, inter alia specifies the person who are required to furnish statement in respect of SFT or reportable account. Section 285A is inserted to provide that apart from those person referred to clause A to K of the said section, the CBDT may prescribe. So they will prescribe. So that power has been given. Means thereby they can add more persons also. Up till now the problem was that they had got only 6 to 7 specified categories, like motor vehicle I was telling you, foreign exchange dealers, and like that only banks, financial institution, like that they are where only 6 to 7 categories. So what about the other categories? Stamp duty authority also was one of the category. Okay, so now this amendment empowers the CG to also notify other person who would be made obligated to file the AIR. So the person presently is only from A to K. So now the list can be increased in subsequent year. Let's see. That is the future. You do not worry at this stage. Point B. Section 285BA defines SFT, Statement of Financial Transaction, to mean any transaction of the type mentioned in Section 285BA A to Section 285BAE as may be prescribed. The second proviso to Section 285BA subsection 3 of the said section specifies that the value or the aggregate value of prescribed transaction during a financial year shall not be less than 50,000. Now this value has been reduced, students, shall not be less than 50,000. In other words, information was required to be furnished only in respect of transaction with aggregate value 50,000 or more. The said proviso has been omitted. Now in that very case, what they have done, so please try to understand logically. They are doing only the amendments, but at least you can still understand it logically. See here, like the jewelers, I was asking about it. They have got the limit that their total turnover, total transaction should be more than 20 lakhs in a year. Only then you will be required to file the AIR. I'm giving one of the extract for the jewelers. 20 lakhs is your, should your be the total transactions in which the AIR has been, PAN has been furnished. Only then you will be required to file the AIR. But when he files the AIR, he will only show about what? Show about those persons' transaction which has crossed the limit of 50,000. Meaning thereby, if you have purchased a 10 gram gold coin and say that is of 30,000 rupees, okay, that in that they would have taken the PAN, but they will not report. So this became a case of what? Tax avoidance. So if I know the income tax well as a CA, I can know that, okay, when the AIR hitting is done. So what I'll do is that I'll buy 10 coins at 10 different point of time, not at one transaction. I'll do a 10 transaction with them and buy 10 coins primarily. And that exactly what I will try to do, by virtue of which not even a single way my name will come in the AIR. This is one of the ways they have thought of avoiding the exposure to the AIR. So I may continue to do 10 lakh of rupee transaction during the year without my name being mentioned in the AIR. And how I have done that? Each transaction value ensured to be less than 50,000. This threshold 50,000 which was there presently, that has been omitted. So now the MCQ question or any question, don't know how the question will be asked, but since it's an amendment, you should know. Now, is there any threshold up to which the reporting has to be done? And the answer is no. That threshold which existed has been taken away. So point number C, if you see, the memorandum has explained this particular point. What they say? To ensure that the filing of information relating to small account of transaction as well. Okay. What is the next one? Section 285BA, subsection 4, inter alia, provides that if a defect in the statement is not rectified within what? Time specified therein, the statement shall be referred as what? Treated as invalid. This is what it is. So earlier, so this was old law. This is the old one. So old used to say what? Invalid.
Now the said subsection has been amended, that if the defect in the statement is not rectified within the specified period therein, the provision of the act shall apply as if such person has furnished what inaccurate information. Now students, what was the difference between old and new? As per the old one, you would be liable for penalty under 271 FA. What is this 271 FA penalty? This penalty was this penalty is when no AIR is filed. No AIR is filed. And now for inaccurate, this thing, the new one, this is the new position. Be careful. This is the new position. Now here the penalty would be, penalty would be under 271 FAA. For inaccurate, the penalty would be under 271 FAA. This is what it is. Please read this two penalties which is following up after this statement. 271 FA and 271 FAA. For FA, you will write also one question which is there in your booklet. But in the meantime, you can go through.
So it is 500 rupees per day for the continuing default. Now the period, why 1st of June has been taken? Because the due date, as I have told you, the due date is 31st of May. So therefore from 1st of June it will take off. So that is what it would be, and accordingly this would be the case. Now inaccurate, which is the amendment part, we will discuss this particular part because this is introduced now. Penalty for furnishing inaccurate statement of financial transaction or reportable account. Section 271 FAA relates to penalty for furnishing inaccurate statement of financial transaction or reportable account under 285 BA. The said section prior to its amendment inter alia provided for penalty of sum of rupees 50,000 if a person referred to in 285 BA clause K furnished inaccurate information in the statement, meaning thereby, are you getting this one? From A to K, the persons are there, isn't it? Up till now, how much we have seen above, in I think point number A itself, above, from A to K, the persons are mentioned. But for filing an inaccurate statement, they have mentioned only the person who is falling in K. And who was the person who was falling in K? Reporting financial institutions. So what about that motor vehicle when you purchase, for which you file the PAN, or foreign exchange dealer, or for that matter, the stamp duty authorities and all, if they file the AIR with inaccurate details, no penalty. Why? Because what the person who was mentioned to whom the penalty would be applicable was only referred as 285BAK. Other persons, if they file inaccurate returns, no penalty. So they used to only worry for one thing, that if they don't file the AIR, that they will have the penalty. But if they file the AIR, which is an inaccurate AIR, they will still have no penalty worry at all. That is what was the lacuna so far, which now got amended. And therefore, see, next paragraph, the said section has been amended with effect from 1/9/2019 by deleting the reference to clause K. So if clause K is deleted, it means now it is only 285BA, not K. After that, so it is now 285BA. So in 285BA, whosoever persons are notified, who are notified from A to K, it is notified. So all these persons are now required to file the AIR. In other words, section 271FAA now extends the penalty for furnishing inaccurate information in the statement to all the persons referred to in section 285BA. The said list, apart from the SSC, includes various government officers. I have told you all these. I have already mentioned. Okay, so this is what it is. So keep this in mind, students. Why I'm saying, because in last attempt they have asked the penalty on this particular part. Are you aware of that? And nobody had any clue about what exactly that provision was. 10 days something was there given in this case, and students were literally clueless about this section. This was this. So you have to be ultra-most careful about this particular part, because you understand the time is full of compliance. We are all in compliance mode. So if the compliance is not proper, then these are the bond pitfalls. Now students, here in immediately, today you will have to wrap up anyhow what all the Q&As, if it is still pending, primarily. Now how you do this primarily, you will have to factor it. But you cannot now postpone or sleep over, because your entire proceeding is over. Full proceeding is done. So one by one, all the segments are getting over. Now what is over now is the proceedings. Now, if I start off with the starting one, started with the PAN obligation, who is supposed to get the PAN, and the substitution of what? From PAN to? From the Aadhaar, those were the case, isn't it? And thereafter, starting with the ROI, who is obligated to file the ROI, and then thereafter the amendment part, wherein the GTI before 54 series of exemption, they will be individual or HUF with the GTI before 54 series of exemption, they will be required to file what? ROI, isn't it? But thereafter, there were certain person who do the transaction, which was account withdrawal or deposit? Account deposit or account withdrawal? Which will be more than rupees 1 crore? Withdrawal or deposit? It is deposit. Deposit where, in current or saving or any? Current account. And in more than one current account, take the aggregate. Why I'm emphasizing? Because the TDS is going to come, and in TDS what will happen there, it will be current account any account withdrawals. Traveling expenditure threshold was 2 lakhs above. These are the things, isn't it? And electricity, 1 lakh. So that is the amount. Electricity, home, office or anywhere? Anywhere. So that is also should be borne in mind. 139.3 loss return, 139.4 belated return, 139.5 revised return. Okay, your return has to be filed within that AY itself. Now if you don't file the return within the due date of 139.1, then there will be certain consequence. More important consequence are the profit link deduction, which will be out. ATJJAA game also will be out. Also what? Also now loss is also there. ATP, that ATP Cooperative Society, also they will be gone. ATQQB royalty also will not be allowed. Why I'm touching upon this? Because these sections we have touched upon already. Okay, thereafter we have moved to the assessment stage, isn't it? Thereafter the first 143.1, that diagram which I have prepared, isn't it? Intimation, after you file the ROI, that the intimation will be given. Intimation, there will be a time limit, isn't it? And then thereafter the scope. The time limit of filing the intimation is 1 year from the end of the financial year in which the ROI is filed. So whichever financial year you file the ROI, within that 1 year period, you will have to give the intimation. Now the scope of the intimation would be any of the three things. What can happen at the most in your return of income? If there is no demand or no refund, then the intimation or acknowledgement itself is your intimation. Whereas if there is a demand, by how come, by the way, demand can arise? How the demand will arise? The demand will arise because the intimation, while sending the intimation, they can do what? Can they rectify any apparent mistake or incorrect claims at the time of sending of the intimation? And the answer is yes. So therefore, because of that reason, there can be some sort of additional liability that will arise. So the intimation that has been given is deemed to be a notice of demand. That is what is the language which I have made you write that time. Intimation is deemed to be a notice of demand. If intimation is deemed to be a notice of demand, we have seen today itself what is the consequence of notice of demand being sent. After 30 days, if you still don't pay, you will be an SSC in default. And if you are an SSC in default, there are consequence of one, interest 220, thereafter 221 penalty equivalent to whatever is the amount that has been demanded. And the third one happens to be the recovery. Recovery which should be by attaching your movable and immobile property. Immobile property, the recovery can go, the sale can take place in respect of your immobile property attached for a period of 7 years, which can be extended to more than 3 years. 3 years. 3 months, no, 3 years. So in all total, 10 years. Okay, so that is what intimation was there. And the refund part of the intimation, in that one special point came, and that special point was, can the refund due, can that be withheld in the giving, can that be withheld? And the answer is yes. The refund which is due can be withheld if the AO is of the opinion that the grant of refund will affect the recovery, then yes, he can go for the withholding of the refund. But procedures are, what is the procedure? He has to take the prior approval from the CIT and he has to write his reasons. Thereafter, he can withhold the refund till the time the assessment is complete. After the assessment is complete, can that refund which has been withheld, can that be adjusted against? Adjusted against what? Adjusted against the liability which has been determined? And the answer is yes. Only point is that the AO needs to intimate to that person, that is the assessee. That exactly it is. There is only one case law to be remembered in the intimation, that was Raghuveer Synthetics Limited. As per that judgment of that Supreme Court, what they have said? They have said in that judgment, what was the judgment in Raghuveer Synthetics Limited? The judgment was that jurisdictional high court judgment is binding. Overlooking that particular judgment and putting forth your claim will make the return having an apparent mistake, giving the jurisdiction to the AO to rectify the same. Isn't it? So that is one of the important case law. After that, we started off with the assessment side. In the assessment side, students, what we have dealt in that regard was that flow chart that you will always keep in mind. In this case, notice of scrutiny is given 143.2. Isn't it? The time limit of giving the notice. Now, in notice of scrutiny, two things I have told. What were the two things? Number one was, what is the scope or the objective of notice of scrutiny? To verify, where they verify three things: understatement of the income, underpayment of the tax, or computation of the excessive loss. That is the objective of notice of scrutiny. Thereafter, what is the time limit? Time limit of serving the notice of scrutiny. Service time limit was 6 months from the end of the financial year in which the ROI is filed. And because of that, there is one section which I have linked with that particular point, and that section was 292BB. If the SSC complies to that notice of scrutiny and does not raise any objection before the AO during the course of assessment, then the notice is deemed to be valid. Deemed to be valid. That is what we have dealt as far as notice of scrutiny was concerned. That gave the proceedings to be pending. That made the proceeding to be what? Pending. Your proceeding became pending. And because your proceeding became pending, that during the pendency, the AO can exercise the powers. Do you agree? During the pendency, the AO can exercise the power. What kind of power the AO can exercise? The power, by the way, why the AO has to exercise the power? Why the AO has to exercise the power? AO has to exercise the power to collect the materials or gather the evidence for the purpose of passing of his order. Isn't it? And therefore, the order which is passed under 143 or under 144 is on the basis of what? On the basis of the information or materials which is gathered by the AO. And therefore, that powers is important. And the flow, if you can recall that flow, 133, 131. 133 was what? Power to give, to collect the information. And if the proceeding is pending, is the approval required from the higher authority? If the proceeding would be pending, will the approval be required from the higher authority in 133? No. If the proceeding is not pending, that the approval will be required. And you can give the this notice of 133 to any person and you can gather any information. That is what 133 can do. And the penalty for that other person, if he does not comply, would be rupees 100 per day. 100 per day is what would be the amount of penalty, isn't it? 131 was for summons, enforcing the attendance of the person, production of the books of accounts, and that books of accounts which has been produced, that can be impounded for a period of 15 days. 15 days that particular books can be compounded, and if there is a non-compliance with the summons of 131, the penalty that was being mentioned was rupees 10,000. That is what 131 was all about, isn't it? And after that, 133A survey primarily, 133B limited survey primarily what we have seen. And thereafter we go went to the next part, which was, okay, what is the last thing, what is the difference between 133B, survey and limited survey? In limited survey, without approval, and limited place, in limited, without approval, limited place. Why I say limited place? Because charitable trust and all cannot be surveyed in 133B, it can be surveyed only in 133A, isn't it? And what else? The power is also limited. What is that? Can he impound the books of accounts? And the answer is no. He cannot do it in 133B. He can do it in 133A. And what? How much is the time limit for the impounding of the books? It is 15 days. 15 days is the time limit for impounding of the books. That is your 133B and 133 respectively. After that, you went to the books of accounts being very complex, isn't it? And volumes and nature of business or transaction, and it is prejudicial to the interest of revenue, then in that case you can go for the special audit, isn't it? But before going to the special audit 142-2A, just check internally if there is any JCIT available expert, isn't it, who can give you the guidance. Now we were doing review itself right now, so review would be done by the JCIT, who are generally more like an expert. So in that very case, do you have any person who can guide you? And that has to be JCIT. Either it can go suo moto from the JCIT himself, or it can be through an application by the assessee or reference by the AO. Either of the three case, the JCIT can grant the direction to the AO, and based on that, the AO will execute his order. However, if there is no JCIT, then obviously the AO is helpless. He will approach the CIT for the special audit, but the CIT, knowing the fact that the expenditure of special audit has to be incurred by whom? Has to be incurred by whom? By the government. That he will first look for 127. 127 is all about what? Transfer of case from one AO to another AO. And therefore, in that very case, he can transfer it. But only one thing is that if the transfer which is made to another AO and that another AO reports to another CIT, then in that case, you have to take a positive approval from the another CIT. Isn't it? That is one of the requirements. And if still there is no such AO available, then please go ahead and do the special audit. And in the special audit, within 180 days, the report has to be given. And the report which has been gathered, that report has to be given to the assessee. An opportunity of being heard has to be given to the assessee on the basis of the special audit report. Only then the AO will pass the order. This is the mandatory step. If there is a lapse on this point of time, the AO does not share the report, special auditor's report, before to the assessee, then in that case, his report will be considered to be null and void. His order would be null and void. In the special audit also, students, any infringement on the part of the SSC, infringement on the part of the SSC to comply with the special audit, then the SSC will have to pay penalty of rupees 10,000. So even that particular point, the penalty of 10,000 was being mentioned. Once that this entire power was being done, then your entire assessment order was through assessment order 143 and 144, which is your regular assessment order. The time limit of this assessment order was given in 153.1, and the time limit was 12 months. And plus 12 months. Remember, plus 12 months was what? TP case. And in TP case, remember, there was plus 12 months for modified return. And there is a pendency, isn't it? At that time, there was plus 12 months, which made it 36 months. That was your TP case, isn't it? And finally, after this, the special assessment was there. the massive chart of 147, AO having a reason to believe, all that. Now, from the AO having a reason to believe, now, in that case, yeah, that the income has escaped assessment. So, he will do what? He will first record the reasons, isn't it? Record of the reasons would be there in the departmental record and not in the notice. Thereafter what? The next point would be, procedure would be sanction. He has to take a sanction. 4 years, if the notice is given in 4 years, JCIT. If it is between 4 and 6 years, CIT. Isn't it? And then he will give the notice under 148. The notice would be as per the time limit of 149, 4, 6 and 16. Isn't it? 6 and 16 are extended period of limitation. 4 is your normal period of limitation. After 4 years, you cannot give any notice if what? The following conditions are satisfied. SSC has filed the return. Assessment has been made and the SSC has given its full and true disclosure in that assessment. If this is the case, beyond 4 years, no notice of 148 can be issued. No notice of 148 can be issued. That is what we have seen for 4 years. 6 years required a monetary threshold to cross. That is rupees 1 lakh. 16 years is in respect of the foreign assets. This is subject to the exception to this time limit of 149 is given in 150. And what is that 150? That notice can be issued any time. 148 notice can be issued any time if it is in consequence of what? Consequence of the decision of any of the court. Okay, if it is in consequence of the decision of any court, then in that particular case, you can then give the notice any time. That is 150. After this, the notice was being given, isn't it? SSC will then file what? Return in response to the notice under section 148. So, this return will be referred to be the return in response to section 148. And thereafter, what happens? Thereafter, what will happen? Thereafter, the SSC, if the SSC asks for the reasons, what prompted you to give me this notice, whether the AO is duty bound to furnish the reasons? Answer is yes. Non-furnishing of the reasons will make the entire assessment null and void. This is what he needs to do, isn't it? That is what the AO has to do in this particular category. After this, what happened? After this, what has happened? Whether the notice of scrutiny under 143.2, is it mandatory? It is absolutely necessary because the AO shall assess non-furnishing of the this defect of not giving the notice of 143.2 cannot be cured by some provision like 292BB, because this is not a procedural defect. You have to assess. He shall assess. So therefore, it is mandatory on the part of the AO to serve the notice of scrutiny. After that, whether the proceedings under 147, can that be dropped? Can the proceeding of 147, can that be dropped? How that is possible, you will say. Can that be dropped? And the answer is yes. If the SSC can show to the AO that he is already assessed on an amount which is higher than the amount which otherwise he is liable for, even though the income which has escaped assessment has been taken into account. In that particular case, the proceedings will get dropped. That is what we have seen in that particular diagram. And finally, we went to the passing of the order. But before the order, we have, I think, has said any new income, can that also be assessed during the pendency of 147? Any new income, can that be assessed during the pendency of 147? And the answer is yes. Question was, can only that new income be assessed? Can only be the new income be assessed? That was the question, conflicting opinion. And there was what? Rendaxi case, which says, no, if you want to assess only the new income, please give the new show cause notice. Whereas there were cases which said, yes, which said, Mehek Finvest Limited, which says that, where it is written, that only both the income has to be given. There is no provision which says that to assess this new income, you also have to assess the old income. No provision says so. Okay. And there was a Govind Raju's case also, which also gave the support. What it says, it was more very logical. It said that if the foundation is valid, then the consequence is valid. What is the foundation? The notice under 148. If that is valid, then the assessment is valid. And how the notice under 148 will be valid? It can be valid It can be valid because of what? If it is, if that notice is challenged and it is proved to be valid, or where it is not challenged, it is deemed to be valid. Where it is not challenged, it is deemed to be valid. This is what was being held. In which case? In the case of Govindaraju. And finally, the order of 147 is passed. 147 order, time limit. Remember time limit? How much was that? 12 plus 12. Always plus 12, keep in mind. 5 plus 12 for transfer pricing cases. And the remaining part, we have seen that that AO shall assess such income. Please understand, in 147, the mandate is to assess only such income. Whereas in 143 and 144, the mandate is to assess total income. And such income means what? Any new claims, ATC deduction, which you have forgotten earlier, can you take it across in this 147? And the answer is no, because the mandate is only to assess such income and not the total income. So the new claims or the matters which has attained finality cannot be revived in the assessment of section 147. Did you all got this one? After this, DOPM, remember DOPM? What is DOPM? Doctrine of Partial Merger. So in the case of DOPM, what we have said, in that case, that any particular matter which has been made as a subject matter of an appeal, on those matters the AO cannot do the reassessment. Meaning thereby, his jurisdiction of reassessment would only be on those matters other than which is considered and decided in the appeal. That is what the concept of partial merger is all about. This is what was your entire 147 proceedings. Then you move to the second proceeding, assessment in consequence of search. 132, the powers, authorized officer, the top officers now should have a reason to believe. On 131 default, 142-1 default, these are defaults which I have not seen practically in my life. But the most important default is what? Undisclosed property. The assessee has got undisclosed income. And if that is the case, they will issue the authorization. And on the basis of the authorization, the search will be extended. The special point that needs to be addressed is that they can seize now the asset as well as the books of accounts, as well as the valuables. In the survey or in the summons, only the limited what they can impound was the books of account. But here they can seize the asset books books of accounts as well as the valuable. But when it comes to a stock in trade, be careful. In that case, if the stock in trade is of jewelry and bullion, the same cannot be seized. And if it is cash, it can be. Deemed seizure, restraint order, provisional assessment. Three boxes always should be there in your mind. And what is a deemed seizure? It is not practicable or it is dangerous in nature. Then in that particular case, the officer will pass a deemed seizure order. Restraint order, I told you. In that case, why restraint orders are to be made? Logic, this is other than the deemed seize order. And for that, you have to have 60 days. 60 days is the time frame for the restraint order. And finally, the provisional attachment. Provisional attachment, I told you that if it is your disclosed property, then your disclosed property, can that be seized? And the answer is no. But to protect the interest of the revenue, can that be provisionally be attached? Yes. But can the SSC make an application to release of that provisional attached property? Yes. For which what he is supposed to do? He is supposed to furnish a bank guarantee equivalent to the fair market value of the property provisionally attached. And that fair bank guarantee, if it has not been renewed within 15 days before the expiry, then the assessing officer can invoke the guarantee, for which he will adjust the guarantee amount against the existing liability, and thereafter with what will put up in the account of the CIT. After this, the assessment begins. Assessment in consequence of search, the previous year of search, and then you figured out what you have figured out, your 6 years, your 10 years, isn't it, the specified period, and between 7th to 10th year that will be available for the purpose of assessment if the total undisclosed property value is how much? More than rupees 50 lakhs. Okay. Now, 153C was also there. If the asset belongs to or books pertains to a person other than the person to on whom the search is conducted, then what will happen? Procedure is, it will be transferred to the AO having the jurisdiction over such other person. Isn't it? That is how it would be. Now, one thing is there, students, once the search begins, the pending assessment will abate. The pending assessment will abate. And if the pending assessment will abate, then what happens in that case? Why pending assessment will abate? Because obviously the search is now supreme. It is having overriding effect. But whether the rectification, revision and appeal, will that abate for that year? No. Those will continue along with this search of 153A. But if tomorrow, if the search is declared as illegal, but then what happens? Then the assessment of 153A will abate. If this abates, then that assessment which got abated, that will get revived. Isn't it? And thereafter, there is a time limit to complete the assessment. That time limit is given by 153B. 153B gives a time limit. Remember, the 6th specified year was there, but the most mysterious one was the 7th year. What the year of search? On which there is a return of 139, on which the order is 143, on which the time limit should have been 153.1, but the time limit now is 153B. This is what is a serious concern. Isn't it? And that exactly was the game. After this, anyway, by the way, the time limit is 12 months from the end of the financial year in which the last authorization was given. Okay, so that is one thing that you should always keep in mind. After the time limit you have seen, thereafter we move to 132B also. And we have seen in 132B application of the seized asset, how a seized asset is applied, that is the application of the seized asset. So, number one, there are part A and part B. Part A was when the assessee, the seized asset was from the disclosed property. So, if the seized asset was from the disclosed property of the assessee, then in that particular case, students, what happened? Then within 30 days from the date of search, what will happen? You have to make an application to the AO. So the assessee will have to make an application before the AO within 30 days from the date of search. Once the application is made, the AO will ask for the nature and the explanation, the source from where this asset has been acquired. And if that has been explained to the satisfaction of the AO, then the AO first will have to take the approval from the PCIT, CIT. Thereafter, what the AO will have to do, he will then have to adjust that seized asset against what? Against the existing liability, and the balance will have to be released within 120 days. 120 days of the last authorization. Okay, part B of the existing liability which was there, part B of the application of seized asset was that balance asset, which is generally I have told you, or undisclosed asset, that balance asset will be adjusted against the existing liability and the liability which is determined on completion of the assessment for the specified period and the assessment for the year of search, including the penalty and the interest thereon. But the liability which is determined, why I am focusing on determined? Because in Hemant Kumar Sindhi and others, Allahabad High Court, it was primarily assessee made an application to the search team to adjust 50 lakhs ad hoc liability. Whether that liability can that be adjusted? And the answer is no. After this, students, what was there in this regard was about the penalty books of accounts also to be released thereafter within 30 days. You have to release it. But if you want to extend beyond 30 days, then you have to make an approval from the CITs. And finally, we went to penalty provisions. And while we did the penalty provision 270A and then 271AAB and 271AAC, that is the three penalty provision that you should always keep in mind. 270A has got under reporting because of misreporting. What will not constitute the under reporting? That is the point that you should keep in mind. One was when the assessee has disclosed all the material facts. Second was when the additions was made on the basis of estimate. And other point to be remembered is a transfer pricing case wherein there is a difference of the transfer price and the ALP, and that difference of the transfer price and the ALP, for that the assessee has maintained the local file under 92D, has disclosed the information in respect of that transaction in that books of accounts. In such particular case, the assessee will not be liable for any penalty under section 92. will not be li- this will not be considered as under reporting. And the last point was, If the penalty is under section 271 double AB, then it will not be under 270A. Okay. Now you just have to ensure, because this would be a practical part. So ensure that whatever the small case studies that we have done for 270A, please ensure to do that, because this is a practical set. You will be getting the MCQ part definitely, if not a separate 4 marks or 5 marks question. So all the practicals that we have discussed on that 270A, ensure to wrap it up that particular thing. And thereafter, students, we went to 271 double AB, which says that at the time of the search only, 271 double AB said what? That at the time of search, the assessee should be disclosing the manner and the nature of the source, the manner in which he has acquired that particular property, plus he should substantiate the entire details of the property which is sought to be seized. And the third one is that he should have paid the tax as well as the interest and penalty before the specified date. If all the three conditions are satisfied, then the penalty under 271 double AB would be 30% of the undisclosed income. If any one of the condition is not satisfied, which in all the case I have told you will never be satisfied, then the penalty would be what? Penalty would be 60%. 60% of the undisclosed income. 60% of the undisclosed income. So this is how it would be considered in this regard. Did you all got this one? Now, for 271 double AB, I told you it can be for 2 years, for which 271 double AB can be charged. Why I am focusing on 271 double AB 2 years? Because for 271 double AB, those 2 years which are being given to you, if it is 271 double AB which is applicable, if it is 271 double AB which is applicable, then in that case, 270A will not apply. So we have to identify for which year 271 double AB will be applicable. So 1 year is the year of search, and even in the specified year, the sixth year can also be considered for 271 double AB if for that AY, as on the date of search, the return filing due date has not expired and the assessee has not filed the ROI. In that case, even that particular AY, which is the sixth AY, the immediately preceding the year of search, that AY is the AY immediately preceding the year of search, even on that year, 271 double AB penalty can be imposed. And as I told you, if the penalty is under 271 double AB, it cannot be under any other section. Any other section means we are talking about 270A. Last but not the least, when 271 double AB and 271 double AC. So when 271 double AB and when 271 double AC? So 271 double AB will be when there is a search. When there is a search, isn't it? Then it is 271 double B. Other than 271 double AB, 271 double AC. 271 double AC. Okay. So other than search, I'll say that way the proper word is, other than search, it will be 271 double AC. That flow you already are aware now. Okay. This was all about the penalty. After that, the cash transaction penalty, three sections, which are the cash transaction penalty? 269SS, 269T and 269ST and also 269SU. So that is the case. Very unique thing. 50 crores last year turnover. Then you have to maintain all the E facility in all your business establishment. Isn't it? So that is the three particular cash penalty which we have considered. And thereafter, transfer pricing penalty already we have considered. So that is already being captured in the transfer pricing topic itself. And the penalty was done. And thereafter, you went to the appeal. And in the appeal, what you have done? Major points has been decoded in the appeal. And what was the major points which was decoded in the appeal? First of all was that particular, the additional evidence point. Appeal monetary limit also has to be very critical. Monetary limit at what level you will file an appeal. Monetary limit, students, are very critical. So that 50 lakhs, 1 crore, 2 crores. So that monetary limit is critical to be remembered for the appeal. Second part, which is about the additional evidence. So I'm just making now checklist, additional evidence, because again, that would be a theory. 4 points were there in the additional evidence. Under what circumstances the additional evidence has to be furnished. So the additional evidence is also the second point. Second is a third point for appeal that has to be remembered is about the grant of stay. So grant of stay, we have seen for the first stay, you have to file with the CID, sorry, with the assessing officer. You have to get the stay from the AO for the first appeal. When you do with the CID appeal, you have to file a stay application with the AO. After that, once you lose the case and you file the appeal before the ITAT, then the stay application has to be filed with the ITAT. The first stay would be for 180 days, and overall extension can be given, but the maximum stay cannot go beyond 365 days. So these are the three very important points, students, that you should keep in mind for the appeals part. Thereafter, we have done 5 hours, and in the 5 hours was, which was the 5 hours? Rectification, review, recall, revision and recovery. That 5 hours is a game. And who can rectify? By the way, who can rectify? Who is the authority who can rectify the order? Income tax authority, ITAT and the settlement commission. They are the three authorities who can rectify. Who can review? Who can review? Who can review? High Court and the Supreme Court. Only they are the authority. And who can recall? Who can recall? ITAT, High Court and Supreme Court. They are the one who have got the power to recall. Okay, what is the grounds of rectification? What are the grounds of rectification? The grounds of rectification is mistake apparent from record. Will be the ground of rectification. The grounds of review would be any mistake and to avoid the miscarriage of justice. And recall would be when there is an ex parte order. Perfect. So therefore, this is what would be the grounds for the review, recall and what? Review, recall and rectification. And then thereafter, the recovery, we have seen notice of demand has to be given, and within 30 days from the service of the notice of demand, you need to make the payment. Failure to pay will attract, will make you an SSC in default, and the consequence of that would be interest under section 220, 1% per month or part thereof till from the expiry of 30 days till the date the payment has been made. Second is about the penalty equivalent to amount demanded. Third one is about the attachment of the property, which we have seen one important rule 68. The immovable property can be attached. The immovable property attached can be sold within the period of 7 years. CBDT can extend 3 years more. And the last but more not the least, 228A, foreign assets. Defaulter, foreign defaulter and assets or resident of India. Okay, foreign defaulter or the assets or the resident of India. Or say, what is the second one? Defaulter in India with foreign connection. Foreign connection means he may be resident of that country or having an asset of that country. Defaulter in India, which example? Vijay Mallya. But although he is not that correct example, but still Vijay Mallya is best to remember. He has given us a lot of legacy in any case. So that is the point of recovery, and then the revision. Revision, students, you will refer that particular chart only, that entire chart. That chart would be remembered by you. AO will pass the order. Thereafter, the CIT will examine. CIT will examine the order. And on the examination, what will happen? The CIT will come to an opinion that the order of the AO is erroneous or deemed to be erroneous, and it is prejudicial to the interest of revenue. So this is what he will say. And then he will issue the show cause notice, isn't it? The show cause notice as has been held by the Supreme Court in Amitabh Bachchan's case. It is a general show cause notice just to give the SSC an opportunity of being heard. It does not set up any sort of a foundation for the revisionary proceedings. So any new matters can be raised, provided in respect of those new matters, the SSC has been given the opportunity of being heard. Isn't it? And that exactly what the important point of the observation of Supreme Court in that Amitabh Bachchan's case is all about. Thereafter, the revisionary order has to be passed. The scope of revisionary order is about the scope. We have seen doctrine of partial merger will apply in the 263 proceedings, whereby we have seen that if any AO's order has been challenged in the appeal, then on that matter, the CIT under section 263 cannot revise. In fact, in 264, he cannot even touch the order. But in 263, on those matter, he cannot revise. And what other he can do? Enhance the assessment, etc., etc., modify and all. Cancel and direct for fresh assessment. And the time limit which has been given is 2 years from the end of the financial year in which the order sought to be revised was passed. Sought to be revised, Lark Chemicals Limited. Okay, if the points is that of the original order, not of the reassessed order, then the 2 years will be considered from the date of original order. Isn't it? That is what we have seen in that particular context. So this is all about your revision, and thereafter where we entered, where we entered after that. Recovery also we entered. Yeah, recovery was already done. And then settlement commission advance ruling. That is a case law, and that is what it is. And this is what it is. Entire proceedings is covered. Right from the start till the end. I have revised each and everything. You just now need to get hold of this particular part. Do it, students. I have done my bit. Now it's up to you how you take it forward from here. Okay?